here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Source Material. My name is Jesse Starcher, and tonight we are going to be discussing probably one of the most popular DC Comics stories ever put to paper. We'll talk about why and maybe how that came to be, but if you've never heard of Kingdom Come, that is going to be the tale of which we will be talking about tonight. It's a story that was written by Mark Waid, and also I believe Alex Ross had a hand in the writing as well, and the art Alex Ross took on with a phenomenal result in this book. So Alex Ross, if anybody has ever had the chance, I'm going to just go ahead and talk about the artist real quick. By the way, this came out in 1996. And I'm going to introduce our guests here in just a second, as soon as I talk about the creators, and then we'll get into our guests, and then we'll talk about the book. So let's talk about Alex Ross real quick. Okay, Alex Ross, if you've ever seen his art style, it's like painted. He uses a lot of photographic references. You see that on a lot of the faces of the characters that he brings about. And he really took the world by storm in a Marvel series called Marvels. Now, he'd been around before that, but when in 1990, I want to say it was 94, Kurt Busiek and him did a limited series called Marvels, and it was very similar to what we see here, where we have a person on the outside watching all these superheroes. He tells this tale of growing up in the era of superheroes. Well, he brought that concept to DC, and we got the result of that, which is Kingdom Come. Now, DC said that they wanted somebody to help write the story or at least pen the story, and the best person they could come up with at the time was Mark Waid. Now, we've actually talked some stories on here about Mark Waid before, or excuse me, talked some, not stories about Mark Waid, but stories that Mark Waid had done. I don't know Mark Waid personally, nor any of his friends, so didn't tell any stories about him. But he has written a lot of comic books. If you go to the wiki, you can see under his bibliography, they actually have his own Wikipedia section for his bibliography. And it's amazing. He's got his hands in DC and also a lot in Marvel as well. I mean, my goodness, this thing, it takes like 20 or 30 scrolls just to get down. And he's also in Boom Studios, a tremendous writer altogether. And he's been around since I remember stories that he wrote since the 90s and possibly even the 80s, mid 80s. Now, let's bring on the guests. OK, we got to introduce our guests here. Returning guest. We last heard from her back when we discussed Mockingbird, My Feminist Agenda. Her name is Alexis Hejna from Honeysuckle Rose Creations. How you doing, Alexis? Thanks for joining us tonight.
Hey, I'm here, and I'm nuts about corgi butts.
Let's get that out of the way right now.
Can we just say...
Exactly. Like, I'm beating you guys to the punch on this one.
Can we just say Alexis has finally crossed over to specialty guest where, like, hey, we need a chick for Chick Week. you're available. Come on. To just regular featured guest. No agenda here. It was like, okay, so now that we're done totally gender biasing you, what comics do you like to read? And she suggested this one. So here we are, everyone.
Yes, Kingdom Come. Now, I want to talk to you here in a second, Alexis, about why you like this book so much. But first, that voice you just heard, Mark Radulich, the patriarch of the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. Are you excited to talk about Kingdom Come tonight?
Yeah, it was interesting.
Okay. All right. Don't oversell it.
I won't.
And returning for, did you say 3 weeks? It's been 3 weeks.
Two.
Oh, that's even better. 2 weeks. Ronnie Adams, who just had unfortunate technical issues, but he has joined us rather unexpectedly on my part. I didn't expect you to join tonight, but then when we decided that, hey, we could do things by Skype, Ronnie Adams like, well, thanks a lot, guys.
Yeah, 2 weeks ago we could have done it by Skype, but you're all like, no, you suck.
Sorry,
nothing
Ronnie
to
Adams.
Do with you.
Ronnie Adams of the Screaming Boy podcast. Yeah. So
no more. No.
No.
This is my time, Starcher. I've been gone. I've been suffering through technical difficulties.
You have.
Yeah.
You have. And I should show you more respect now that you've been back, and that now that you are back, and you are in our. You
have should. But probably won't.
Won't happen.
No.
All right, Alexis. Tell us about why you decided that the first book that you would like to, I don't think I've ever had you on here before other than when, with Mockingbird, which was something that we chose. So I usually love to have our guests pick a book to talk about. So I think this was like top of the line for, or this was the top of the stack for you. Tell us a little bit about your, what brought you to Kingdom Come and why you chose it tonight.
Well, first of all, I do need to announce, if you guys hear some coughing in the background, that's me. My allergies are, they just hate me right now, and I've been having problems with my throat. I just took a shot of cough syrup, so hopefully that'll make things better, but I'm apologizing in advance if I need to pause and just cough a lung.
Oh, you go right ahead. They have been hitting hard, and I'm not a guy that really suffers from allergies, but I'll tell you right now, the past, like, week, I have been, my eyes were like dry and watering, and I'm like, what is going on? And my wife's doing the same thing. The kids are all hacking and coughing, and I was just like, what is, I thought it was a cold at first, but no, I honestly think it's allergies, man. It's hit a lot of people hard. So yeah, no problem at all. Good thing is I've got the editing machine, and you'll have, you could hack for like 3 minutes. It'll all be gone.
Hooray for hacking. Awesome. Well, in answer to your question, Kingdom Come is actually one of the first comic books I ever bought myself.
Okay.
I got into comics a little late in the game. I hear so many people say that they were raised on comics and, you know, they remember going as kids to the comic shop. And I didn't get into that. It wasn't until a couple of years ago. I was actually going to go see Age of Ultron with some friends. But the movie didn't start for an hour. We were just hanging around a bookstore, and I wandered into the comic shop, and I saw the cover for Kingdom Come. It was sitting down on the shelf, and I was just blown away by this art style. It was so gorgeous. You were talking about Ross's painting style. Kingdom Come is actually painted with, it's pronounced differently every time I talk to somebody, gouache or something like that. Again, I've heard it pronounced different ways. It's a very different painting style. You don't see this typically in comics.
Mm-hmm.
But it gives this incredible realistic approach.
Yes.
And I just was blown away by the style, and I thought, I have got to read this.
I've seen other painted books before, other artists who have tried to paint comics, and I've never been more impressed with anything I've ever seen in my entire life, other than what I see here in, well, what Alex Ross has done with Kingdom Come and Marvels.
Have you ever read Marvels?
I don't think I've read all of it. I know I own a couple issues, but it's one of those things where I'm like, okay, I got to read the whole thing. And have you, Mark? Did you read it?
No, I mean, I flipped through it. I know it's there. It's something I think at some point we should do on the show, but I've never actually
Absolutely.
Read it.
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree. As a matter of fact, just before I forget about it, in the last panel that we're going to talk about tonight, in the last panel of the book, you see Norm and the Spectre sitting at the bar. On one side of the Spectre is the main character from Marvels, and on the other side is another character from Marvels. So Alex Ross painted him in there, but of course, you know, unless you knew
Alex
what
Ross can do what Alex Ross wants.
Yeah, let him have it.
Apparently, this whole thing is very much laden with Easter eggs.
Yeah, did you see? I just saw that tonight about how Fat Albert and the gang was the gang that the Bat-Bots were chasing in Gotham when you first go into Gotham. That's Fat Albert and what's the net? I can't remember the net rest of the game. Is it Get Along Gang or something?
No, it's Fat. That's not the Get Along Gang. That was a moose and.
Wow.
It's Fat Albert and the Cosby Kids.
There we go.
It was okay. Mushmouth and...
Yeah. That's the only one I remember is Mushmouth.
Yeah, I can't remember the rest. Yeah, it was Fat Albert and Mushmouth, the only ones I remember.
So, Alexis, you saw the trade. You said you were at a bookstore, so I assume it was the trade paperback, right, on the shelf?
Yep, I'm actually holding the book in my hand right now.
Nice.
Go ahead and grab it and keep it on hand for tonight's podcast.
And did anybody suggest it to you, or was it just something where you were like, that art style is amazing, I've got to read this?
It just stuck out to me. No one else had suggested it. I had seen Alex Ross's work before. Truth be told, if you looked into comic books in any way, shape, or form, chances are pretty good, you have seen a painting of his. Mm-hmm. I find it interesting how many people say they have no idea who Alex Ross is, but when I show them the very famous painting of Joker and Harley Quinn, Joker in his tux, Harley Quinn dancing around with her arms up over her head, they've seen that. They just didn't put two and two together and realize it was his.
Yeah, as soon as you put that name to that art, you'll know the next time you see something, oh, that's definitely something Alex Ross has done.
Mm-hmm.
Very distinctive and just absolutely beautiful art style. So when it comes to artists, this guy's definitely probably top 10 in my book, and I assume easily in a lot of others. Mark, Kingdom Come, you ever read it before we got into this one tonight?
No.
Oh, so this is the first time you got to experience this then?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So I'm curious as to how, you know, what your thoughts are going to be. Ronnie Adams, you've read Kingdom Come before, haven't you?
I have.
That's what I thought. What do you remember when it was that? Did you buy the issues or did you buy the?
No.
No.
I read the trade.
Got the trade suggested by anybody or just decided that was it like
through the grapevine? You know, everybody recommended it. I don't even know if it was Wizard, to be honest with you.
Really?
Yeah. But, I mean, you saw it everywhere.
You did.
Just as was mentioned before, if you know comics, if you've read comics, more than likely, just as Alexis said, if you've seen comics, if you're into comics at all, you've seen Alex Ross. Mm-hmm. And it was just one of those things where the art was just the same thing. Art was gorgeous. I've heard a lot of people talk about it, and I was like, I got to give this a try.
Yeah. I think I was right along there with you, man. I'd heard it through the grapevine. I don't know if I'd seen it much in Wizard. This came out in 96, which was the heyday. Wizard had just gotten started, like, I think, maybe 3 or 4 years before Wizard Magazine. Ladies and gentlemen, just in case you've never heard of Wizard, Wizard was a magazine, probably one of the more premier magazines for comic book news. So whenever something hit the comic book shelves that really took the world by storm, it was usually going to be in there.
Obviously, I was aware of it. I've seen it advertised in places. It's been talked about. But honestly, I didn't really know anything about it until I read it today, and you know, because it was suggested by Alexis to do on the show. I don't know. It's not a bad tale, obviously. I mean, it's won awards. People, you know, it's like top five graphic novels you have to read and all of that. I think my problem is one of those where it's like, I'm like a kid who saw the prequels first, the Star Wars prequels.
Because this is where I think, like, Injustice.
Oh, you stole my thunder, you son of a bitch.
I knew that shit would influence you, too. I was like, he's read Injustice, and now he's got to go back and read, like, 1996, Mark Wade, bringing this to the table, to the forefront. This wasn't the norm back then.
Right. I was doing some secondary reading on it, and it said that this really wasn't editorial about how dark and gritty and ridiculous comics had gotten in the 90s. You know, everybody had to be the Punisher. And so I liked that aspect of it, but again, reflecting on that in 2018, you know, we're going through this with the movies now, where despite the fact that Jeff Johns was said to have commissioned this because they wanted to do a treatise on how ridiculous and dark comics had gotten, and then you look at the DC Cinematic Universe, where they're really wrestling with, why does everything have to be Batman? Well, everything has to be Batman. And I know that some of that is profit-driven, that Batman movies tend to make money. But still, it's interesting that this was written in 1996 about something that was going on at the time, and we're still kind of struggling with the same motif. And that's entirely separate from the idea of writing a story from the point of view of, well, what if the superheroes just went crazy and started doing whatever it is they wanted to do? How would that play out? And again, you know, go back to our Injustice podcast from a few months ago, how much I love that story. Reading Kingdom Come after having read Injustice, I'm like, I've read this before and I enjoyed the previous story. But that's not the takeaway from this one.
Here we go. Now, this is probably going to take about 5 to 10 minutes. I'm synopsis. Yeah, I'm condensing the story into a few paragraphs here. So here we go.
What's
now, you guys
again?
Hop in. I didn't say it the first time. I couldn't. Condensing.
I don't know what you're trying to tell us. What's the word you're trying to say?
I was trying to say synopsisize. That's not a word, though. Shut up. You made me say it. All right. So, yes, condensing this into a few paragraphs, you guys hop in. Stop me, whatever, if you want to. You know, we'll talk about whatever you want to here. I know I've covered the biggest plot points, so here we go. All right. So in the not-too-distant future, superheroes have become commonplace in the DC universe. One can say they are overrunning and overburdening society, so much so that the human element still exists, but is almost an afterthought. It is not uncommon to see a battle between some heroes and villains at least once a week in certain spots of the nation, leveling buildings, causing damage, sometimes with little care for loss of civilian life. There is also a very glaring absence among the superhero community, that of Superman. After his wife Lois was killed along with others at the Daily Planet by the Joker, Superman sought justice. But a vigilante superhero named Magog, or Magog, killed the Joker in front of thousands of people, bringing an end to his reign of terror. Superman believed Magog should stand trial and be punished for this murder. But when Magog was acquitted, Superman
lost... differently every time you say it.
I do that. It might be a gimmick. I don't know. Superman lost faith in the justice system and humanity, so he secluded himself away from everybody. I have to do it again. It isn't until Magog leads a group of superheroes to Kansas in order to capture the parasite, tragedy hits. The atom is ripped open, and the resulting explosion kills scores of people. This awakens Superman's, after Wonder Woman comes to him and talks some sense into him, Superman is sent on a path to right the ship and get the metahuman population back under control. Of course, there are those that don't fall in line, so a large gulag is built on the ruins in Kansas to house and re-educate the metahumans that are causing trouble. And it isn't long until the prison is full and a plan is made for a breakout. We soon find out that this has been a plan of Lex Luthor's all along in order to bring down Superman's heroic regime. And when the jailbreak occurs, Luthor unleashes his secret weapon, a brainwashed Billy Batson, the all-powerful Captain Marvel. During the intense battle waging against most of the world's metahuman population, Captain Marvel and Superman square off. It's at this time the UN makes a decision to drop a nuclear bomb on them in order to possibly save humanity from the unbridled fury of the metahumans. Superman makes the decision to sacrifice himself, but Captain Marvel immediately makes the choice to stop him and takes the brunt of the blast, killing himself and many others in the process. Consumed with rage, Superman flies to the UN to bring wrath upon those that undoubtedly sealed the fate of many he called friends. It is at this time the hero of the story, a failing preacher by the name of Norman McKay, a man who has bear witness to all of these events at the side of this mysterious specter, makes his appearance. McKay reasons with Superman to make him understand that his thirst for vengeance will eclipse the humanity that Superman has been striving for. Superman comes to realize that Norman is right and that himself and the other heroes need to work alongside humanity instead of over it in order to solve the world's problems. All right, there we go. So that right there is a very, very condensed version of what we get in Kingdom Come. Mark, I mean, you got something you want to talk about here. What do you think of the story that you read? Since you're the one coming into this all fresh and new, what do you got to say?
Well, when you need someone to kill a person and make a hero go into retirement, there's only one man to call, and that's the Joker.
Yeah.
That was kind of my first thought. You had mentioned in the chat, Jesse, that the Captain Marvel Shazam Superman showdown was kind of a highlight of the book. Mm-hmm. In terms of just pure action. And I would agree with you. That had a very cinematic quality to it. I have to say, this is probably one of the first times I actually enjoyed the art more than I did the story. The photorealist...
Photorealistic art. That's rare coming from you. Yeah.
Yeah. Photorealistic art probably might be my new favorite type of art in comic books. I could stare at these pages all day. I mean, this is stuff that I would hang up on my wall, some of these panels.
Cool.
But I will tell you again, it's a little unfair. I think it's a little unfair. When I think about my reactions to the book, they're a little unfair. Because again, who do they use? What character did they use to kill Lois and people at the Daily Planet? The fucking Joker. Injustice. Who goes crazy and whispers in Superman's ear, "You're not tough enough, start killing people"? Wonder Woman. Injustice. And I wish I hadn't read Injustice first. I wish I had read this when it was contemporary, you know, and I could give it the proper credit that it's due, because it really does deserve it. But it's a lot of the same repeated tropes that we've seen in these Elseworld tales where the heroes lose their way. Is there ever a story where Batman doesn't have the thematic or the moral upper hand on Superman?
Yeah, and most of them suck.
Okay, fair enough. Because that's another trope that I keep seeing. It's that Superman is portrayed as idealist, or he's very concrete in, you know, in a negative way. Again, injustice, you know, my heart is broken and therefore everyone has to die. That sort of thing. But it's like in every story, I grant that if you take away Batman's sort of moral superiority and his intelligence, there's nothing left. It's just the guy running around in tights punching people. So you got to give him something. But I feel like Superman never gets the better of Batman. Now, Alexis just said, sure he does, but those stories stink. And okay, that's fine. Nothing that I've ever read where Superman ever wins the moral argument. You know, I was telling Jesse when I read Emperor Joker, I always find Superman stories to be the least interesting because he's so overpowered that you really have to think about how are you going to present a serious challenge to a guy, to a god who can do anything. And that's probably the strongest point of the story for me. Superman's powers are sort of pointless in this book. This is a book about choices and morality. Superman spends most of the book just completely and utterly conflicted as to what to do. He has his sort of moral upbringing turning him one way, and then Wonder Woman pulling him another way. You know, and then all of these tragedies sort of piling up on him, and he goes on. You know, he's reacting on instinct to a degree, and then questioning himself. And I thought the ending of it was really interesting because, again, it isn't just Superman rushing to save the day and everything works out for everybody, you know, and all of that. He says to Shazam, either you have a choice as to what to do, and I can't make that for you, but you're going to have to make a choice. I thought that was a fun and interesting way to handle it. And, of course, you know, they end up detonating one of the three missiles and it kills some of the heroes, but not all of them. So... Mm-hmm. You know, that's kind of my takeaway from the book.
Yeah, Superman was ready to full-on kill himself and allow Billy Batson, who the big concept here is the division between humanity and superheroes, okay? Regular human beings and superheroes. And Superman looks at Billy and says, you need to understand something. I'm about to go kill myself. You've been a superhero and a man. You are both. Only you. So I think initially his intention was to leave Captain Marvel down there to lead the rest of the superhero population. But of course, Captain Marvel makes the decision to sacrifice himself, which is pretty interesting, and leaving Superman the one to do it and to deal with the aftermath. Which then, right there, is almost like your seed for injustice. Like, where what if it's the classic what if? What if, you know, Norm McKay wasn't there to talk him down? Then you got Superman wreaking havoc and becoming what looks to be like we see in Injustice. So, all right, Alexis.
Well, the whole idea of power corrupts and Superman losing himself through his grief is nothing new. Again, I have also read the Injustice books, played through the Injustice games. I know that this is nothing new. But I feel that what helps separate this is actually the character of Norman McKay, who, interestingly, I was doing a little research. McKay was actually modeled after Alex Ross's father, who was a minister.
Oh, wow.
And the name McKay is an homage to cartoonist Winsor McKay, creator of the Little Nemo series.
Very interesting.
Mm-hmm. It was like little touches like that. And I kind of like that because in so many other variations, we are presented with the black and white argument. Superman is in the right. Superman is in the wrong. We either see things through Superman's eyes or through Batman's eyes or something like that. And it's very hard to, you know, really gather who is in the right and who is in the wrong. But by having McKay as this observer with the specter, we gain a much different insight into it. And that's what I enjoy so much about the book, that we're actually able to see more of it from a third-person perspective. It's not bludgeoned into our faces who's right and who's wrong. And I think that really all comes into the climax, where the specter basically tells McKay, okay, who lives, who dies, who's right and who's wrong? And McKay is the one who says, you're full of crap. This is not a black-and-white issue. I know what to do. And that, I think that really speaks true to the series and to the idea of the comic in general, that it's not always going to be a black and white issue. Even something as simpler as Magog, whatever, you know, killing the Joker. And so many people say, yes, that's what I was supposed to do. But not even that's a black and white issue.
that was a very interesting twist on, you know, Superman getting so Clark Kent getting upset with just humanity and how they thought that that vengeful act of killing the Joker was the righteous one. And at that point, when they made that decision, he was just like, okay, I'm out. I'm done. And you're right. It is perfectly indicative of a gray issue. It is something that people could have a hard stance on one way or the other, but really the answer never lies in one of those in one of those takes, whether it be black or white. It's always somewhere in the gray where usually the answer has to be found. Also, McKay does, as a character, I think McKay represents us, the reader. You know, he's obviously the guy who's watching all these events unfold like we do when we read a comic every day. Like, but every time you put a comic in front of you and you watch all these events unfold, that's exactly what happens to McKay there. He also has to struggle in this fictional universe to come up with a solution to what's happening in the book. But obviously the difference between us and McKay is the fact that he has a voice. He's able to talk to the superheroes and tell them, okay, look, this is what you have to do, which I thought that was pretty neat. That was just kind of the neat little concept that I took away from it. Ronnie Adams?
When I first read it, I really loved it. I thought it was because it was something different, you know? I wasn't that into DC, so I wasn't into their whatever they call their what-ifs, their Elseworlds, their, you know, things like that. This was definitely something that I enjoyed because I hadn't really read anything from DC like this. I didn't go into it, you know, watching the prequels first. And yeah. But the funny thing is, though, the more that I've, you know, read Injustice and read things like that, I'm like, huh, you know, history repeats itself almost. It's not that they didn't come up with, you know, they couldn't come up with a fresh idea or anything. It's just that it almost gave me a, you know, been there, done that feeling with Injustice.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as this goes, when I first read it, I was like, I loved it because mostly, you know, the art is intense and the storyline was good, you know, and it was definitely something that I hadn't seen before.
One of the notes that I made down here was how when they drew the panels, when Alex Ross, you know, put these panels together, you know, the first, like, three issues, you have this very, very crowded feel. That's the kind of feeling that they want you to get. The fact that the world is so, you know, amassed with all these superheroes. I mean, there's like panels where, like, I don't know, 10 or 12 superheroes are battling each other. And you get that throughout the series.
I don't know if it was meant to be self-referential or self-parodying, but some of these panels where they're having a meeting where it's like the Mankind Liberation Front and Batman's Outsiders, and there's just people standing around in their whore costumes. It's like, these are people in suits trying to come up with a plan to deal with the crisis, and there's people standing around in the background looking like they were at Fantasy Fest, you know, in Key West or some shit like that, or what's Burning Man? You know, it's like, come on, why would you show up like that? And I realize, like, that's their costumes, but that's the whole point. You know, it's like, if you think about, like, the X-Men movies, you know, the X-Men had some fantastic artwork and really, really fun and interesting costumes. And then they got to the movies and were like, this will look ridiculous on screen. How about we just put them in black leather?
It's all black. Yeah. Well, the thing is that it's obviously, and I'm sure I'm not, you know, I'm not bestowing any knowledge upon you here, Mark. But, you know, if you just took, you know, said superhero like Zatanna, which I don't know if any of you know who Zatanna is, but she
Zatanna?
Is a...
Zatanna?
Zatanna?
Magog?
Sure. Magog. Shmageggy. If you just
Shmageggy.
If you took her and took her out of the fishnets and the top hat and put her in regular clothes, I don't know if you're going to recognize her. So it's a necessary evil, Mark Radulich. I'm sorry. You're going to have to look at Green Arrow. And, of course, Green Arrow's got that signature. I don't think you'd actually see him initially in his getup. You could just tell Ollie Queen is Ollie Queen just by the facial hair. I wanted to talk about the crowding. I don't know if you guys noticed this or not, but I thought this was really interesting. If you notice that the first three issues are the covers have got heroes just all over them. All over them, and it makes it feel like it's just heavy with superheroes and supervillains, whatnot. And then the final issue is just Superman all by himself. which is very, very telling of the story after you look at it. So very cool stuff.
Well, I do think it's interesting when you talk about the covers and the superheroes are all over the place. I do love the drawings of all the superheroes clustered together. It's almost kind of like a yearbook photo in a way. It's just kind of interesting, although it does make me laugh because in the parade, in the back, they actually have them all listed and they have them numbered so you can actually figure out who is who. And I appreciate that, but at the same time, I'm looking through going, what order did they number these things? It's like, one's here, two's down there, three's over there, five's over there. What the hell? So it's kind of a pain to try to figure out, wait, which direction are these things going in again? Yeah, there's a thing in the back that shows those three photos of all the heroes and villains all gathered together that you see in the series. And it's numbered, so you can figure out who is who.
Okay, that's pretty cool. Well, let's go ahead and get to some questions. I'm going to pull Robert Winfrey tonight. I am going to – well, actually, I'm not going to. You guys are.
You're going to tell us you hated it?
No, I'm not going to tell you that. I'm going to read some reviews that I found online, a couple of them as a matter of fact, and we'll see if you guys agree, disagree, whatever. Then we'll kind of close up shop. This will be a quick one tonight, so which is perfectly fine. It's a fantastic story. I honestly would suggest anybody out there get their hands on this and read it. It is a good, good tale, and it's spectacular to look at. So, all right, Mark Radulich, first up here, all right? So I went on to Goodreads, and I found a guy who wanted to state his opinion. This is dark and right-wing reactionary garbage. It's scary because it doesn't seem far off. Everything new or different or changed is bad. Also, everyone in the Justice League except Batman and Flash just abandon everyone. Throw in the weird religious blunt hammering over the head, just not my cup of tea. Mark, what do you think of this guy? Do you agree, disagree?
I mean, it sounds like somebody who's very threatened by anything religious and definitely has framed superheroes in a certain way in his mind, and anything outside of that box he's going to condemn. I feel like the person who... I don't agree with any of that at all. First of all, here's what really bothers me about a comment like that. Let's have a character who is a religious authority figure. Now, that character would probably say and do religious-type things. And then the reader is supposed to draw from this that you're being hit over the head with religiosity. Like, well, that's the character in this. What did you want him to do?
Yeah.
You know, whatever the reason, I mean, you could have chosen anybody, really, to play the everyman role. They decided to go with somebody who, you can just assume by right of his chosen path that he has a very dedicated sense of right and wrong. And I'm not saying every religious figure, you know, is always in the right. Clearly, we have situations where religious figures abuse their power. This is not the time nor the place to have that discussion. But what I'm saying is, if you... hey, Ronnie, I have a screenplay idea for you. But the point of it is that if you're going to have an everyman character who at the end of the day has to make a moral judgment that's going to affect the lives of hundreds of people, possibly millions, you know, in terms of like secondary and tertiary effects, why not pick a reverend? Why not pick a priest? So, you know, I to me that made sense. And I don't think there's a difference between pushing an agenda and just using a theme or a motif to further illustrate your point. And I believe this book does the latter, not the former. This person could have been watching porn, and if a priest walks in suddenly, you know, into the frame, suddenly you're pushing a religious agenda. It's like, all right, you're a little oversensitive. I don't know about you, but I watch lots of porn where a priest just walks in the frame.
I don't even know where to go with that. I have no idea.
I don't want to go anywhere with it.
Oh, yeah. Let's just stop that right there.
I'm not saying they do anything. Just kind of walk in. They're holding up a sign. You know, whatever. Anyway.
Let's not put any more visuals out
there.
That
sounds like a bizarre Monty Python skit.
Yeah, don't talk to Jesse about Monty Python. He don't know nothing.
I have no idea.
he said it so sad when he said that.
I've tried to educate the man. He won't look at his own Facebook page. As far as this being like right wing, I mean, they're struggling over people, you know, misguided people abusing their power. I'm not entirely sure I see where there's a right wing agenda being pushed here. Or am I not understanding his statement?
Well, I think I agree with you guys that he probably sees the idea of a minister and assumes that this is going to be Christian theology bludgeoning over the head. And I will say that I am never the person to defend Christianity. I am, you know, and I'm not atheist, but I'm not going to go into a diatribe about my belief system because there's really not enough time on this show. So we're just going to say I'm not atheist, but I'm not Christian. So usually, yeah, I'm the first person to say, oh, God, Christian theology, scab. But I feel that the idea of this is not Christianity. It's not religion. It's spirituality. It's the concept of all of us as human beings knowing right from wrong and realizing our capacity to choose right from wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel that having a minister who is losing his faith and has to regain that ability, I feel that that's a very strong point. I do not feel that this is a very overly right-wing Christian book in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah, I don't know where he's getting it from. I mean, I certainly didn't feel like the weird religious blunt hammering over the head. He just quotes from the Bible, he's actually quoting from probably one of the most interesting parts of the Bible, which is the one that, you know, talks about how the world is going to end. You know, that's movies and plenty of stories have been based upon that throughout time. Ronnie, okay, right wing,
yeah.
Garbage, weird religious blunt hammering over
the head. If it's right wing, you got to talk to Ronnie about it.
I mean, did you feel like that? Did you get that the sense of that from this book?
No.
And I didn't think so. Okay. Well, I guess we're all in agreement. Let's talk about question number two. We'll start with you, Alexis.
Number two of 70.
only four total, so we'll be all right. Alexis, did you feel there was a message here? I think you kind of already alluded to it, but did you feel that there was a message here? And if so, do you know what the message possibly is?
Yeah, I think I kind of did talk about, again, the idea of find that there is right and wrong in all of us and that it's not always a black and white issue, but we still have the capacity to choose right from wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that that is the message, without being too ham-fisted.
We put a lot of faith into our leaders, the people who, politician, religious leaders, whatever, and there's a lot of not working along with the people, but more along the lines of ruling over the people. That is one of the things I take away from it, is that, you know, Superman believes humanity has lost its way, and the only way that humanity is going to get back on track, or superheroes are going to get back on track, number one, he's got to get his own people in line first. And once he does that, where does it stop? So I think at the end when he decides, okay, everybody's out of control, you know, you guys just dropped a bomb on my head. You dropped a bomb on me,
Sam. Can I throw this out there? Is it weird that...
That's the line you draw?
I sing when I want to sing, sir.
That's true.
I'm not your monkey. Anywho, is it weird that after everything that Wonder Woman and Superman went through in this, they had a kid?
It did seem kind of out of... I mean, I thought they were really at odds. And then there was, you know, after everything happened, I don't know, a year passed. So they obviously...
Yeah, a year passed. I can forgive you becoming a homicidal maniac, sure.
You know, I have to add, that is one of the few things I wasn't crazy about. But I'm also one of the people who is really against the whole Superman and Wonder Woman party should be together thing. Maybe because I'm just not into shipping fictional characters like that.
Are you more of a team Wonder Woman Batman gal?
You know what? Actually, I kind of am. The Timiverse Justice League animated series is one of my favorites. So I think I kind of fell into that a little bit more. But again, I'm not really into the whole they should be together so powerful. But I guess I always just like that, yes, they're two of the most powerful beings on the planet. But I feel that they balance each other a little bit better as friends. You know, I'm not just the whole they should be together because it's so iconic. It's like, give me a break.
Now, there's a sequel after this series, and they're called Thy Kingdom or something. What is it called? I think it's just called The Kingdom. Now, I haven't read that. I own it, though. Thank you, Ollies. Speaking of Ollies, I own it. So I'm curious as to whether this – because at the end of the issue, we didn't talk about this in the synopsis, but that at the very end of the issue, they were like, yeah, hey, we want you, Bruce Wayne, to be the godfather of our son. And
which,
so,
again, I had a real problem with. It seemed weirdly out of character.
Okay. Well, I mean, these superheroes, you could just look at Bruce Wayne. How old would you say Bruce Wayne is in this comic, Mark?
About 100. 80. Yeah, 100.
guy's pretty old.
He's wearing He's wearing like an Iron Man exosuit through this whole thing.
Clearly,
his muscles have like entropied.
Well, I like to think that he's wearing that suit because you guys have seen The Dark Knight Rises, right? The third Christopher Nolan Batman movie.
Yeah, the one that makes no sense and is a horrible piece of shit. Yes, I've seen it.
I'm not defending the movie in any way, shape, or form, okay?
Okay.
I'm not a fan either. But there's a scene I remember where he's at the doctor's office, and I remember that's just a ploy for him to get to see Gordon. And the doctor says something like, no, you don't understand. You have no cartilage.
Right.
Like, you have nothing to see about.
I don't suggest you should go spelunking.
Yeah, something like that. I like to think that the exosuit's not so much he's that old, just more all the damage that he has done to his body has caught up to him. I like to think he's probably not that old. He's probably maybe not even 60 years old, but with the crap he's put his body through, it's either that or he's going to get seriously addicted to painkillers. Take your pick.
You know, why can't somebody write that story? Like a Batman just fucking doped up on opiates and like his, and his insurance got canceled. He can't afford the opiates anymore. So he goes into the night and he starts beating street thugs for their fucking heroin.
Because they tried that with Red Arrow, and it got annoying.
Okay.
Mark, is there a message? Is there a message? Did you get a message out of this?
Don't lose sight of who you are deep down. Stay on the path.
Are you signing our yearbooks, or are you trying to tell us the message?
Well, no, I honestly...
Don't ever change. See you next summer.
All right.
Six tops.
No, I honestly believe that. I think some of the message here is it's harder to do the right thing than it is to do the wrong thing, though the wrong thing feels really, really good, and it's easier to do.
Okay, Ronnie?
I was going to do something with signing your book, but I got nothing.
We'll always be friends.
Wait for this thing going, oh, that's a great message. Or did you just like, hey, that was a great story?
That was a great story. Okay. I mean, let's be honest. I'm not the most intuitive person in the world when it comes to messages and stuff in media. But it was a really good story.
Okay. All right. Now, Alexis, I'm going to go to you with this next question here because this is the first comic you ever bought. So take us back to when you pulled this off the stands and you read it. When you were first diving into the world of DC Comics and Kingdom Come, which is actually a really crazy starting point, in my opinion, to hop into comics, did you feel overwhelmed or lost at any time when you were reading this?
You know what? Actually, I didn't. And I credit a lot of that to, once again, the Timiverse. I actually got into a huge argument once with another major comic book aficionado, old girlfriend of mine. She was talking about this guy who had come up to her at a Comic-Con and had this very, I know this much about comics attitude. But when she pressed him, it found out he had never read a comic in his life. He had simply been watching the Timiverse animated series, the Batman series, Superman, Teen Titans, Justice League. And I commented that, okay, yeah, that is a little holier than now. But the fact is that series, all those series, were such a great entryway for people like me who did not get a real opportunity to read comics when we were younger, just weren't introduced to it. Mm-hmm. I was able to identify a lot of these characters because of, wow, this is going to sound lame, but because of all the TV I'd grown up watching.
Well, that's good. I mean, that's actually a testament to what kind of is going on nowadays. You see our comic book superheroes on the big screen and the Marvel Cinematic U and the DC Extended Universe. That's a very good supporting argument as to why the movies and the TV shows should continue. Now, as to whether there's an oversaturation of those at this point, that's a debate we could have at some other time.
Oh,
but
shut up, James Cameron.
I'm just going – I will just say that, you know, that's served its job. So you felt comfortable going into this universe. You recognized – I would say at least all – did you recognize all of the big players in this story?
Majority of them. I remember scratching my head when they got to the villains table and said that Selina Kyle had married Edward Nygma, because I was sitting going, okay, I know this is Elseworlds, but huh?
Yeah, what? And... Well, Mark, how about you? Did you feel overwhelmed or lost at any point in this book?
I thought the thing with Magog had happened in the past. I didn't realize that it was present day, so I had to kind of go back and read plot synopsis to get myself straightened out. Why are you sighing?
Never mind. You just say it wrong.
I'm the last person to cast judgment upon the pronunciation of Magog.
Anyway, so as I was trying to say before I was so rudely interrupted by a sigh, when Magoo was... Mr. Magoo and Company nukes Kansas, I thought that that was something that happened in the past that had driven him away, not a contemporary thing.
How about you, Ronnie? Did you feel overwhelmed or lost at any time?
Nah. No. Shoot. I mean, I've read most of the crises and everything else. I think I can handle this.
You'll be all right. Yeah, you read Crisis on Infinite Earths, and you can handle that. I think I'll agree with you there. You're probably going to be okay here. I love Elseworlds stories. We've talked about this plenty of times on this podcast. I'm a big fan of the What Ifs from Marvel. Elseworlds. Ronnie, you said you didn't like them too well from DC.
No, I just didn't know them.
Didn't know them. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's a very similar concept. There's some really good stories out there, but this is by far one of the best ones for sure. So, all right, last question. Here we go. Alexis, you get first shot at this one as well. So here we go. Kingdom Come should be, this is a statement here, and we'll see if you agree or disagree. Kingdom Come should be in the Holy Canon. I don't know what that means. Holy Canon?
It's kind of hard to say, honestly, for me. I mean, I know, again, a lot of people feel that it should be in the top 10, but sometimes I mean, again, the story's amazing, but sometimes I wonder if there's more favoritism placed on it because it is an Alex Ross work. Mm-hmm. Again, the artwork is some of the most beautiful in all of comics. There is no denying that. So it's kind of hard to say. It's like, are people saying that because they truly feel that the story is amazing, or are they saying that because it is a gloriously gorgeous comic book?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm kind of on the fence about it, honestly. I think it's an amazing story. It's one of my favorites. But
you have where would you put it personally? I mean, for you, if you had to go and rank stories that you've read, and you know, just out of what you read, where would you put it at? Top 5, top 10?
For me personally, I'd probably put it top 10.
Okay. Mark Radulich, so what do you think? We've read a lot of stories together on here, and you've read quite a few, and we haven't had a chance to talk
about. I've made fun of all of them.
Where's it place?
I mean, it's probably up there. It's definitely top 20. Maybe even top 10. I mean, it's a well-written story, and the art is beautiful, so I think that bumps it up maybe past my personal enjoyment.
Okay.
The art is so good. But I feel like in 2018, the message has been heard and talked about, and stories have been written about it again and again and again. And its only contemporary value is that the movies are now struggling with the very same thing. Like, the comics, I think, have dealt with this already. You know, I mean, if you look at Rebirth, right? You know, Rebirth was an attempt to set the DC universe in a light that was more appealing to fans, if I remember correctly. They've acknowledged that everything can't be Batman and the Punisher, or some amalgamation of the two. I don't think the comic books are really currently struggling with this sort of thing, but the movies are, and that's where the value is. But I don't necessarily need to read Kingdom Come to know that.
Mark, at this time in comic book history in 1996, Image Comics had been around for, I think, close to 4 years. One of the reviews I was watching earlier, I think it was last night, they were talking about how this might have been like an answer, or maybe possibly at least alluding to some commentary about how all the superheroes had gone extreme. We had one of my favorite superheroes.
They were
Supreme.
Wrestling in barbed wire and explosions?
Buddy, I'll tell you right now, that whole era.
Let's do it.
Yeah, that whole era. I would love at some point to cover some Image Comics with you. I know Spawn's coming up, so we'll have to go back and do some early Spawn. But, you know, the Blood and Guts era, you don't see that a whole lot in DC and Marvel. But 96 Image, it was all over the place. So, Ronnie Adams, what do you think, man? Top 25, top 10 greatest stories ever written for superhero comics. Where would you put this at and everything that you've read?
It's definitely one of the most important stories, I think, that you could read as a comic book fan. because it set so many bars for everything else as far as Elseworlds and what ifs and everything else, because of the art, because of the story, because for me it did, because I hadn't really paid attention to anything else like this from DC. So for me, not saying that it is going to be true for everyone, This is a very important, you know, it was one of those books that I heard about, just kept hearing about and hearing about and hearing about. It was almost like, what's the word I'm looking for? One of those, I guess, like a holy grail of books you had to read.
Okay. Mark, you had that list there you shared with us not too long ago. Do you remember if this was on there? Like the 25 most important graphic novel? I think that was...
Pretty sure, yeah, Marvel, it was. This Marvel and Marvels.
Yeah. Yeah, so... Kurt Busiek does a series called Astro City, which at some point I would love to talk
Gary
about. Kurt Busiek.
Gary Busey does a series of comic book stuff?
Mother Fuddrucker. it is Kurt Busiek. He's the guy that wrote Marvels. He's kind of taken that concept and took it over to an independent publisher, and I think it's called Astro City, if I remember correctly. And I haven't read much of it. I just know I've heard a lot of people talk about it. So if you like this type of story, that might, especially if you like Marvels, that might be something that kind of we may look at in the future, and you guys may be interested in reading. So, Ronnie, you ever read any Astro City?
No.
Alexis, you ever heard of Astro City?
Actually, no, I haven't.
Okay.
Can we get a Kickstarter to actually open up a planet Krypton? It looks like just so much kitschy fun.
That is absolutely correct. I would love to see something like that. When they just walk in there and there's the guys dressed up like all the DC superheroes, classic stuff too, like the Aquaman green and orange. It did. It definitely did. And it's funny. I love how they end on that too in the series, as Clark and Batman and Wonder Woman are sitting down to eat at the place. I thought that was pretty cool.
I just love all the little Easter eggs in the back. I mean, I don't know if you guys, did you guys see Jonah Hex's corpse in the background of those scenes? No, seriously, this is actually canon within the Kingdom Come series. When Planet Krypton is opened, Booster Gold purchases, Jonah Hex's corpse is involved, and it is toured because everybody wanted to see Hex dead, and it is actually purchased by Booster Gold and set up at Planet Krypton. And if you guys look at one of the bigger shots, it's still freaking there.
Oh, wow. I do know I saw when they were sitting there talking back and forth about, you know, the baby coming up, I think, if I remember right, as Clark, Wonder Woman, and Batman are eating. In the background, you can see this older gentleman and, like, his grandson walking up onto the cosmic treadmill. And I was like, wait a second. That better be a replica. I hope that it's not the real thing, because there's going to be some trouble. But, yeah, that was one thing I noticed right before we got on here tonight. So it is chock full of neat little references, and Alex Ross did a great job of just kind of shoehorning in there, and maybe some people recognize it and some people don't. Well, let's go ahead. We shall get into plug. Alexis, you have suffered tonight, not only with allergies, but putting up with our nonsense. So I am going to turn the microphone over to you and allow you to please plug everything and anything that you got coming up, upcoming. Tell us what the con scene's been like. Have you been having a good time? What's up on your end of the woods over there?
All right. Honeysuckle Rose Creations. We're right in the middle of our busiest part of the con season. We just finished back-to-back shows with Anime Central in Chicago and Phoenix Comic Fest in, well, Phoenix, which is apparently getting redubbed Phoenix Fan Fusion of some or something like that next year. I don't know.
Is it because of that? Is it because of that whole suit about Comic-Con that was it Wizard that laid down or
San Diego?
San Diego.
Yeah, I should actually note Honeysuckle Rose Creations has officially declared we will not be applying or having anything to do with San Diego Comic-Con International until they pull their heads out of their butts.
Please,
the corgi butts.
Yeah.
What are corgi butts?
Yes. The corgi butts.
What did I miss with San Diego?
San Diego, go ahead.
San Diego Comic-Con, you guys know, was the big international Comic-Con in over the summer. They have officially declared that the phrase Comic-Con is trademarked, and they are taking lawsuits out on virtually any other show that is...
They pulled a Super Bowl.
Sure.
No, the NFL trademarked the word super, the word Super Bowl.
Yeah, but there wasn't like.
But you,
there wasn't like thousands of Super Bowls all over the country.
No, but there's thousands of commercials that can't use the term Super Bowl now.
Oh, gotcha.
I mean, even down to my church was told not to use Super Bowl party because we had to call it the big game party.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's gotten pretty ugly. Phoenix has had to rechange their name, and they're going to change it again. We are attending Salt Lake Comic Con, which is one of the bigger shows that has launched a countersuit against San Diego. We're supporting Salt Lake in this, so we will be attending that in September. Our next show, however, is the Greater Austin Comic Con, and down there in about 2 weeks. After that, we're going to be in two places at once, actually. I'm sending my team to Tokyo and Tulsa in July. And myself and my intern slash little sister slash slave labor will be working Crypticon here in Kansas City. Well, it's officially St. Joe, but that's like 45 minutes north. What are you going to do? It's actually our first horror show. We are really looking forward to it. We're going to have a bunch of brand new products tailored for that market. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Very good. Very good. Well, Alexis, I appreciate you very much coming on the show tonight, and especially to get to talk one of your favorite comics. It was my honor and my pleasure to do that. So I'm glad to give you the opportunity to talk about it yourself. So, Mark Radulich.
Well, real quick, Alexis, here's what we got going on in the very near future, in case you're interested. I don't know if you saw the post. I guess you did, because that's where the confusion lie. But just one more time around the clock, we're going to rock. The Trial of Galactus, Justice League America, Salvation Run, Luke Cage, Sins of the Father, Ant-Man, Second Chance Man, Incredible Hulks, Planet Savage, Lobo, Highway to Hell, written by Scott Ian of Anthrax fame, Green Lantern, Planet of the Apes, X-Men Legacy Volume 1, Barbed Wire, Barbed Wire.
Yep. Is that, do I have that in there?
This is past where you stopped the calendar. Okay. Ronnie's really looking forward to. Exit Stage Left, The Snagglepuss Chronicles.
No. Murgatroyd.
No.
I was waiting for a real go fuck yourself there. Archie versus Predator, Justice League America, The Tornado's Path, Deadpool, Dracula's Gauntlet, Venom, Lethal Protector, Zatanna, by Paul Dini, Halloween, Night Dance, Batman, Haunted Night, we've already talked about DC meets Hanna-Barbera 2, The Unworthy Thor, Batwoman, Elegy, which right now it's penciled in. I'm trying to do it the week that they do the next Arrowverse crossover. Superman versus Muhammad Ali, Hawkeye Volume 1, My Life is a Weapon, the Harley Quinn Holiday Special, and then when we end the year off with a real bang, Aquaman from the New 52 Volume 2, The Others, and Transformers Bumblebee. Anything tickle your sack?
At the moment, nothing's really jumping out at me, but if there's anything you think that I could offer an opinion on, if you need, again, more of a female point of view on any of them, I'm happy to jump in on, just pick up the comic book that you guys are talking about.
So that's all the source material stuff we have between now and the end of the year. In the meantime, let's get to stuff that's a little bit closer to home. What debuted today on the Radulich and Broadcasting Network, if you listen to this on YouTube, is mostly Jesse talking about Cloak and Dagger. Lost and Found.
Yeah.
I was just kind of there, telling my son to go to bed. Tomorrow is the on-trial Civil Court edition. The 1995 Oscar debate. Who should have won, Forrest Gump or The Shawshank Redemption? I am arguing for Forrest Gump, and I will be arguing against The Shawshank Redemption, and Sean will be doing the opposite. Jesse's favorite album of the year, it was highly recommended by Ronnie Adams, Lordy, Sexorcism, will be reviewed.
No, don't say stuff like that. People will believe you.
On the Metal Hammer of Doom. And that's it for this week. Next week, this will air on the Source Material podcast. Jesse and I are going to attempt to review Krypton from the Sci-Fi Network. I have no idea what happened on this show, so lots of luck. It's going to be a lot of me reading a Wikipedia page and asking Jesse, what did he think? And then we're either going to review Ghost Prequel or Amorphous Queen of Time.
on the Metal Hammer of Doom. Possibly, not listed yet, but possibly we're also going to... We might be doing a special Because You Made Me featuring Robert Winfrey. He wants me to go see the documentary Won't You Be My Neighbor. If I can, we'll probably do a show on it. So...
That looks so good.
I've heard a lot of good things about that.
Yeah, so that's what's going on right now. And, of course, in the near future, we've got that Fantastic Four book the same week as The Incredibles 2. We've got Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom the same week as Salvation Run. I'm going to introduce Jesse to some Nine Inch Nails he's never heard. So we got a lot of fun stuff in the month of June.
All right, very good. Ronnie Adams, tell us what you got going on, Ronnie Adams.
Severe crippling anger.
Not your feelings, sir.
No, sorry.
Your shows. Tell us about your shows.
I have a show called Scream Boy Podcast where we talk about just about anything pop culture and, you know, whatever tickles our fancy. We haven't done a show in a while because of just stupidity on technology's part. We'll get back in there hopefully eventually, but you can enjoy all the old stuff on iTunes, TuneIn, Stitcher, and iHeart, as well as the Radio Lichen Broadcasting Network, where they have a couple of episodes that I do not because I cannot edit them at this time. But we do the director's cut, uncut, unfiltered shows, and we send them over to the Radio Lichen Broadcasting Network, and then we put the others on our end, I should say, but. Because of technical difficulties, we have not been able to do that. So we'll be back before you know it. Other than that, I am going to be attending Raleigh SuperCon in July, where I will hope to meet Ralph Macchio, Mick Foley, and because my sister requested it, Joey Fatone.
Ladies and gentlemen, go give the Radulich in Broadcasting Network Facebook page a like to stay on top of all the great content that we have to offer. Yes, you can follow the Source Material Facebook page as well. We will be posting all of our shows right there and anything else we find entertaining. All right, for Alexis Hejna, for Mark Radulich, for Ronnie Adams, my name's Jesse Starcher. This has been Source Material's coverage of Kingdom Come. We are out of here. Bye-bye. Oh, we can be heroes just for one day.
No, I keep wanting to go, oh, look, this, you know, because that's what...
Because Mark Radulich.
Yeah.
Why would you do that? We have a guest on this show. I don't understand why you would make fun of her name like that.
Oh, what a jerk.
Mark. Alexis, I promise I know your name.
Superman believed that Magog... Magog.
How about Magog? How about
Magog? I've always heard it's Magog.
Yeah, Magog.
Let's go with Magog.
Superman. Magog should stand
Magog.
Trial. Magog?
Magog.
Magog.
Okay, I'm calling it Ed. Just pronounce it however the hell you want. It's okay, we're dwelling on this more than you dwell on my name.
Alexis, I tried to... No, not you, Amazon Echo thing.
Yeah, right. See? I knew it. I freaking knew it.
Speaking of penises, back to Kingdom Come.
God almighty.
Words that should have nothing to do with each other, but unfortunately do.
I'll end by saying this.
Jeez. I think you've said enough.
Is it actually titled Cameron Saves Christmas?
Yeah, you've never heard of that?
That's the title?
That's the title.
Awfully, I don't know, egotistical to save Christmas by yourself there, sir. Kirk Cameron.
Kirk Cameron needs to stop.
Ernest saved Christmas one time, and if Kirk Cameron
it's
not a comic.
Ernest saved Christmas. So Kirk's going to try to follow that up.
Oh gosh, what's the? It's actually named
after his sister got addicted to drugs. Though.
Vertigo,
the one they actually call Speedy.
I believe it was Vertigo, or it was something else that gave him phenomenal strength, and he got addicted to that. But it was a steroid, and it made him crazy, and he was throwing people all over the place, and eventually he had to come off of it.
Are we going to pay attention to Ronnie, who has told you multiple times that the one that they actually call Speedy was hooked on drugs too?
Oh, okay. Was that his sister?
I'm going to.
Welcome back to the podcast, Ronnie Adams.
We've missed you, sir. Is it anything like the holy hand grenade?
I knew there was going to be a Monty Python.
Not our fault. You don't know good things.
Thou shalt count to three. Not.
Sorry, go ahead.
Give a head, brother.
Fucking Monty Python.
You say that with respect in your voice.
Listen, I'm going to need you to edit all this unprofessional shit out, okay, Eddie? Okay, Jesse?
Who the fuck is Eddie?
I corrected myself, Eddie.
Apparently you are Eddie.
You know what? Actually, I haven't read the new one. I got the old one right here that's got Marvin the Martian versus Marvin Manhunter.
We did that one last
year. Wow, that's actually harder to say than I thought.
Just say John Jones. He asked a social media group that reaches the span of the world what time a movie was playing. What's even worse? People answered him.